我们的信息。并且说我们继续说我们的对话 Restoring God's plan for the family.
Today we'd like to continue in our series Restoring God's plan for our family.
Can I see the seven question on divorced and remarrying number two?
So today we'll be in, tackling the part two of the seven questions on divorce and remarrying.
哥林多前书第七章是哥林多教会写培文保罗尽罪讲到婚姻的代志。
In 1 Corinthians chapter 7, it speaks about a lot of things regarding marriage.
保罗一个问题来解答。
And one by one, Paul was answering the questions that people had during that time.
顶礼拜咱解答了两个问题。
Last week we talked about two questions.
Question number one. 哥林多教会问保罗新的生活。
The church in Corinth, the people there asked Paul, is sex a spiritual matter? Why was the people in Corinth asking this question? Because Corinth was a very big city. It was a very big place, just like United States, just like Canada, just like maybe the city of the country of Hong Kong. But it's very depraved. And we find it interesting. When they are poor, they don't dare to do things. But when they are rich, then they will have a very depraved lifestyle. During that time, the people there were living in depravity, especially with regards to sex. Because inside the city of Corinth, there was this very big temple.
The temple 里面看到几千的女的祭司。
And inside the temple, there were 1,000 lady priests.
这个 lady priest 扎扎就是祭殿里面的妓女。
These priestesses were prostitutes.
所以常常跟这么人发生性的关系。
So they often have sex with the worshippers there.
当人信主以后
，After they became Christian, the people there became Christian.
真侪人可能有安尼款的无好的经验。
Probably a lot of them had this not so right experience in the past.
就是不及这款的妓女发生这款的 sex relationship.
And they have the sexual relationships with the prostitutes, with the temple prostitutes.
所以感觉性是个肮脏的物件。
So they felt that sex was something that is filthy.
所以问保罗这个 question.
So they asked Paul this question.
性的生活是不是属灵的呀？
Is sex a spiritual matter?
保罗答案是讲 yes.
Paul's answer was yes. But you have to have sex within the bounds of marriage. If sex was done outside of marriage, then it's something not clean. But sex within the bounds of marriage is something clean, something holy, something honorable before the Lord.
Question number two.
The second question they asked was, may someone who had once been married remarry again? Before I became a Christian, I was married. But right now I'm single.
可能我的 partner 已经走了。
Probably my partner departed from me or deserted me.
我现在有当重新结婚呗。
Can I remarry?
保罗讲 yes.
Paul's answer was yes.
因为在主里面是新造的人。
Because you are in Christ, a new creation.
但是保罗的答案是叫做 yes, but optional. This is your choice.
But it's a qualified yes. You have the option to marry or not remarry.
你这个选择结婚，也就是选择唔通个结婚。
You have the option to choose to marry or not to marry.
So it was not
God's plan for us to force us into marriage.
Yes, it is option.
It's your option. But you have to remember,
not the one who can free to make any decision.
We have
many
this
choice.
Free will to make our own decisions.
但是某这个人有当避免隆重的决定的后果。
That we are not free to escape the consequences of our decisions.
所以呢，看清以后。
So once you're married,
有看清的问题。
You have this problem in marriage.
无看清有无看清的问题。
You're single, you have problems with singlehood.
And this is your choice.
This is your choice.
你该选择看清还是无看清？
It's your choice to marry or not to marry.
因为你已经有经验了嘛。
But because you have this experience,
你知道什么叫恳求了啊？
You know what marriage is all about.
什么叫靠排面了啊？
What you know what it means to be in despair after marriage.
你还靠排面一摆， that's your choice.
If you want to continue on in despair, then it's your choice.
This is question number two.
This is question number two.
Question number three.
And question number three. May divorced people remarry. It's not about for those who have been married, but it's about those who have been divorced. From chapter 7, verses 10 to 16, we can find the answers to this question. In this answer, Paul brought up three different situations. The first situation, if both parties are believers, I'm Christian, you're a Christian, and after we are divorced, can we both be married again? What's Paul's answer? To the married, I gave this command, not I, but the Lord. A wife must not separate from her husband.
Not I, but the Lord.
Not I, but the Lord. This is something that the Lord said.
A wife must not separate from her husband.
You cannot separate. If you're a wife, you cannot separate from your husband.
11.
Verse 11 tells us, but if she does, she must remain unmarried or else be reconciled to her husband. And a husband must not divorce his wife.
This is
the first situation that Paul brought out. If both parties are Christians, it is not my command, but it's the Lord's command. You cannot divorce. Because it is in God's will, neither parties can depart or can desert each other. It is God's command that Christians should not divorce. This is God's absolute will. But because man refused to submit to the Lord, that's why they divorce. But if you are already divorced, I give you two options.
Option number one,
you cannot remarry.
Option number two,
you need to reconcile with your
partner.
The first is you cannot marry again. Because it's wrong for you to divorce. If you marry again, you are committing another mistake. As Christians,
listen.
Don't cover your sin, your mistake with another mistake. Don't cover your sins or your mistakes with another mistake. You cannot cover up your sins or your mistakes and make it right by committing another mistake. Don't continue on in your sin or your mistakes. Remember,
God is a consuming fire.
God is a consuming fire. You cannot just be casual with
God's command.
If God does not punish you, doesn't mean he agrees with you. God is waiting for us to repent. Do not remarry. Another option. To reconcile with your partner. This is the best choice. After you divorce, I'm not married, she's not married. Let's reconcile. And you restore your relationship. This is the best choice. But this is the reality in the world.
I'm sorry.
Pastor, I'm sorry. We're already divorced. I'm remarried. Or she's already remarried. I cannot reconcile with her anymore. Because I'm already married. She's already remarried.
What should I do?
What should I do?
Listen.
Number one. You need to go back and confess and repent of your sin.
I'm not joking, okay?
I'm not joking.
Sincerely confess your sin. Repent.
You need to come before the Lord, confess and repent. Because you have compounded your mistakes upon mistakes. And you are adding to your sins. If you don't repent right now, when God passes on his judgment,
you feel very regret.
You truly regret what you have done.
So number one,
option
都叫认罪悔改。
Please go back to repent.
Number two.
Don't divorce anymore from your present partner. Continue on and establish a good relationship with your present partner. Seek the Lord. May the Lord be merciful towards you. In God's will, there are two kinds of will.
Absolute will and permissive will.
That's one is the absolute will and the other is God's permissive
will. Absolute will is God's permissive will.
It's when God makes an absolute judgment or absolute pronouncement.
And
those are things that are non-negotiable. God will never change on those things. For example,
信耶稣是 by faith 上帝恩典，这是永远未改变的代志。
When you become a Christian, it is by faith, it is God's grace. This will never change.
不是靠你行为。
It will never be dependent upon your
word. 这个是 absolute will.
This is absolute will.
什么叫 permissive will?
What is permissive will?
是上不是第好的旨意 ，not the best.
This might not be the best for you.
但是因为你强强坚持走路落去。
But because you are persistent in going down that path,
so God say allow you.
So that's why God will allow you.
But it's not the best will of God.
But it's not God's best will for you.
So I ask you to help us.
May the Lord help us.
If you have already again, it's not the best will of God.
If you are remarried again after being divorced, it's not God's best plan for you. But because you're already in that situation, after you confess and you repent, you need to maintain and establish your present situation. And may God's mercy be upon your life. This is the first option. If both parties are believers.
But
the second situation,The unbeliever is willing to live with the believing spouse. That because of your faith, differences of faith, and before you're not a Christian, and you became a Christian, your spouse remains a non-Christian. And the partner said, it's okay. I will not divorce from you. What do you do? What did the Bible say? To the rest, I say this.I, not the Lord, if any brother has a wife who is not a believer and she's willing to live with him, he must not divorce her. And if a woman has a husband who is not a believer and he's willing to live with her, she must not divorce him. For the unbelieving husband has been sanctified through his wife, and the unbelieving wife has been sanctified through her believing husband. Otherwise, your children will be unclean, but as it is,They are holy. This is the second situation. Before, both of you were non-Christians. But one person in the partnership became a Christian. The other remained a non-Christian. It became a union between a Christian and a non-Christian. So somebody brought out this question. Somebody said that God will not bless a union between a believer and a non-believer. So that's why you need to separate from that non-believer. If not, then God will not bless your marriage. Paul said, no. You don't need to divorce. If your unbelieving spouse is willing to remain with you, then you cannot divorce him or her.
You get it?
Remember, the one who is the unbeliever chose to remain with you. It's her choice or his choice if she or he wants to remain with you or not. If that person is willing to remain with you, then you cannot divorce that spouse. Why? Verse 14. There's this very unique explanation.
The unbelieving husband has been sanctified for his wife, and the unbelieving wife has been sanctified for her believing husband. Otherwise, your children will be unclean, but at least they are holy.
What does this mean?
Those
unbelieving husbands, they have been made clean because of their believing wife. Those unbelieving children, they have been made clean because of their believing parent?
是不是讲义？因为信主了，将救恩赏给恁的丈夫，赏给恁的太太。
Does it mean that because we are Christian, we are bringing salvation to our unbelieving family members?
No.
No.
这个讲 sanctify, 圣洁。
Here it means sanctify.
不是讲救恩。
It doesn't talk about salvation.
你记得。从来无因为老爸信主，囡仔信主；从来没丈夫信主，太太都信主。Never ever happen.
There will never be a situation wherein one person is will become saved because of their unbelieving because of their believing partner. You cannot be saved because of other person.
救恩永远是个人的代志。
Salvation is always and will always be a personal decision.
不是三个信主是个别 individual.
It is an individual decision, never a collective decision.
So, 基督教有一句话真特别。
That's why there is this unique statement in Christianity.
上帝只有子，上帝无孙。
God only has children. He does not have grandchildren.
You know what?
You know why?
上帝只承认子，上帝从来无承认啥是我的孙。
God never said that I have grandchildren. He only recognizes his children.
因为信耶稣是你跟上帝个人的关系，跟你的父母完全无关系。
Because it has nothing to do with your believing parents, but it is something to do with your personal relationship with God.
But, 当你信主以后
，After you've become a Christian,
你也找到这个 channel of blessing.
You will become a channel of blessing.
因为上帝祝福你。
Because God will bless you.
你有当将上帝祝福接到你的生命，传到你家家顺顺，包括你的丈夫跟你的太太。
And through your life, you can bless.Your family members who are unbelievers. And it's possible. Your blessing can flow through to your children.
So, Christian, 当你信主，当你出来老人无信主的时阵
，There are non-believers in your family.
你的责任真简单。
Your responsibility is very simple.
你需要找这个 channel of blessing.
You have to become a channel of
blessing. 我来问我这个问题。
One person asked me this question.
你好，牧师啊。
So, pastor.
我丈夫无。无信主无得救，是不是我的问题
？If my husband is not saved, he's an unbeliever. Is it my problem?
是不是我的责任
？Is it my responsibility?
I go no.
I said no.
Wow, you go praise God.
And that woman said yes, praise God.
我哋真侪人讲，你若无你感情无信主，你就唔对咯，你就唔对咯。
A lot of people say feel that if their husband is a non-believer, then it's their problem, it's their responsibility.
哦，你囡仔若无信主，你就父母唔对咯。
If your children are non-believer believers, then it's your problem as a parent.
No.
No.
这是那个修诶
，because this is only something of our made out from our mind.
But
listen.
你若做丈夫
，if you're a husband，
你若无做丈夫诶责任
，you don't do your responsibility as a husband.
好，你太太无看到什么个是基督徒诶丈夫，这是你诶责任。
That your wife failed to see what a Christian is supposed to be, then it's your responsibility.
你做父母
，as a parent，
你若无看到。囡仔无看到我的父母是什么 Christian parents， 这是你的问题。
Then your children have not ever seen what a Christian parent should be. Then it's your responsibility.
Wife, submit to your husband.
Submit to your husband.
你的丈夫若从来无看到你 submit，
if your husband never have experienced you submitting to him，
husband, love your wife.
Love your wife.
你的太太从来没看到你听伊。
And if your wife have never experienced love from you,
伊就信主啊。
How can they become Christians?
所以你的见证的问题。
It's a question of your testimony.
保罗讲。
Paul said.
有第二 situation.
This is second situation.
那无信的。
If there's an unbeliever.
伊讲咱无必离婚。
We will not divorce.
咱信主人未最要佮佮你离婚。
If that unbeliever refuses to divorce from you, then you cannot divorce that person.
相反呢
？On the other hand,
maybe because of your good testimony.
Maybe because of your good testimony.
你有将上帝恩传到你家家顺顺。
You can bring blessings upon your children and your grandchildren.
你讲我爸爸信主哦。
You know when my father became a Christian.
跟我妈妈有绝对性的关系。
When he became a Christian, it has something to do with my mom's faith.
我 parents 都唔是信主嘅。
My parents were not Christians.
后来我妈妈，我信主以后，我从我妈妈信主。
After I became a Christian, I brought my mom to the Lord.
等我妈妈信主以后
，After my mom became a Christian,
我老爸非常非常生气。
My father was so angry.
因为
When I became a Christian, my father remained silent. But when my mom became a Christian, my dad became very angry. Because nobody will bring offerings to him or to the idols. But my mom was very gentle. She never answered back. No matter how much my father would shout at her or ridicule her, she remained silent. And my father later on went with my mom to the church for 20 years. 20 years and he refused to be a Christian.
Every Sunday,
but every Sunday he would go with my mom to the church. Later on, I became a pastor. I'm here in the Philippines. One time my mom called me up. Said, my son, your father is now a Christian. He wants to be baptized.
Oh, good, very good, praise God.
And I was so happy. I said, praise God. But your dad wants you to go back to Hong Kong and to be the one to baptize him.
Why not?
And I said, why not?
So
I flew back to Hong Kong. And I baptized my father. After my father is baptized, my father got baptized. It's because of my mom's testimony. So Paul brought up this second situation. If this unbeliever is willing to live with the believer, you cannot divorce. And there's this third situation. If this unbeliever wants to leave or wants a divorce, how do we resolve this? Look at verse 15. But if an unbeliever leaves, let it be so. The brother or sister is not bound in such circumstances. God has called us to live in peace. I want you to take note of the last sentence. God has called us to live in peace.
God has called us to live in peace.
There's this very important principle here in this sentence. God wants us to live in peace. God does not want us to be quarreling with each other. Verse 16, how do you know, wife, whether you will save your husband, or how do you know, husband, whether you will save your wife? This is the third situation. Before marriage, they're both non-Christians. And one of them became a Christian. The unbeliever, I cannot live with you anymore. So we they will say that you always are in the church, you're always worshiping the Lord. Let's just divorce. What did the Bible say? Let them go.
Let them go.
Because God has called us to live in peace. This is a very important principle. After we become Christians, we are children of peace. We are not children of war or quarrel. We don't want to be troublesome. We don't want to quarrel with other people.
We are not the son of trouble, we are son of peace.
We are not son of troubles, but we are son of peace. If the unbeliever wants a divorce, let him go. Because God does not want us to live in a situation wherein we're always quarreling or fighting with each other. But where is the important point? When it's something that has been brought up by the non-believer, a believer should never bring out the option of divorce.
So, divorce is not a Christian option.
It's never an option for a Christian to be divorced. But if the other party wants a divorce, let him go. You don't have to be sad.
Let him go.
After they have departed from you,
you are free.
I don't know if you completely understand what this passage is talking about.
How do you know, wife, whether you can say your husband, or how do you know, husband, whether you will say your wife?
What does this passage mean?
Let me explain to you.
Paul was saying, as husband or as a wife, don't you know that you have within you the power to save your husband or your wife. This non-believer, if he's willing to stay,
that's great.
Because there is a possibility for you to share the gospel to that person and to bring them to salvation.
The same principle.
If the unbeliever wants to go, let them go. Don't you know? Don't you know that God can use that situation to bring that other person to Christ? What does this mean? God is not encouraging us to divorce. God can use any circumstances to bring people to the Lord, including marriage and divorce. We don't know how amazing God's work is. Sometimes in good situation, we become saved. Sometimes in situations that are troublesome, we become saved. May the Lord help us. But God's principle is,
it's not God's will.
If you're always quarreling and fighting in your marriage, that is not God's will.
Question.
How about if you're in a situation where you're always fighting in your marriage today, even though you're not divorced?
It's not God's will for your family.
It's not God's will for your family.
Something wrong in your marriage.
There's something wrong in your marriage.
So then a conclusion.
So our conclusion is,
situation,
in the first situation,
number one,
both parties are believers.
离婚是无允准,
divorce is not permissible. Unless, as I've brought up in the past, there is a case of adultery.
So divorce is not permissible.
Divorce is never permissible.
但是,
but what if you're already divorced?
世俗已经remarried,
what if you're already remarried?
Number one.
Confess and repent before the Lord. Don't wait for God's judgment to be upon you.
Number two.
Establish a good relationship with your present spouse.
Live in peace.
Second situation.
If
the unbeliever is willing to live with you, and they want to continue on in this relationship, you as a believer cannot demand a divorce.
So
continue to live with that person. The third situation. If the unbeliever wants to divorce,
yes. Let him or her go. You are free. Then I will marry. Okay.
It's okay for you to remarry them. But remember, you should never be the one to initiate the divorce.
You make a mistake.
If you're the one who initiated it, then you're making a mistake.
Okay,
is it clear?
Is it very clear?
So we are here tackling about those who are divorced, can they remarry again? The fourth question. The people in Corinth asked Paul, does our original identity change when we become Christians? In verses 17 to 24, we can find the answer to this question.
The key verse
can be found in verse 17. Nevertheless, each person should live as a believer in whatever situation the Lord has assigned to them. Just as God has called them, this is the rule I lay down in all the churches. What was the last sentence?
This is the rule I lay down in all the churches.
All of the churches should follow this rule. What does this mean? Church in Corinth asked Paul this question. After I've become a Christian,
I'm a new creation.
I'm a new creation. This is my status. That's my status. Change? If I'm married, but because I'm a Christian now,
就改变我的身份，变成single了，及即是无信的崩溃。
Do I change my status to become single and divorce as a non-believer?
还是我是single?
Or do I become a single?
但我信主了。
But or as a single, I become a Christian.
我是不是需要找一个信主的姊妹结婚 to become one?
Do I really need to find another part, a Christian or a sister to be married?
那你记得讲代志吼。
You have to remember one thing.
耶，咱信主是 new creation.
Yes, as a Christian, we are a new creation.
但是
but
你的身份未改变。
Your status will never change.
你是别人的丈夫，永远是伊的丈夫。
Before you were a wife of somebody, you remain the wife of somebody. Or the husband of somebody, you remain the husband.
永远是伊的太太。
Or if you're the wife of somebody, you remain the wife of somebody.
冇因为信主改变一切。
Not because it doesn't.Follow that you are now a Christian, your status will change. Probably you cannot understand this. That's why the Bible used two examples to explain this. The first is about circumcision. Look at verses 18 to 20. Was a man already circumcised when he was called? He should not become uncircumcised. Was a man uncircumcised when he was called? He should not be circumcised.Circumcision is nothing. Uncircumcision is nothing. Keeping God's command is what counts. Each person should remain in the situation they were in when God called them.
Each person should remain in the situation they were in when God called them. 上帝呼召你的时阵
when God called you,
你信主的时阵
after you've become a Christian,
你是什么样的身份
what kind of status you have,
你就保守你的身份
you have to maintain that status.
受割礼 circumcision 是指犹太人
when we talk about circumcision, we're talking about the Jewish people.
无受割礼是指外邦人
for the uncircumcised, we are referring to the Gentiles.
当你得救的时阵
after you've become a Christian,
你是什么人
what kind of a person you are,
继续做什么人
you continue on in that status.
你是中国人
If you're Chinese,
你信主又继续做中国人
you continue to be a Chinese after you become a Christian. If you're Filipino,
你继续做菲律宾人
you remain a Filipino
你是美国人
you are a Christian. If you're an American,
继续做美国人
you continue to be an American.
无上国家有无上国的文化
each country has their own culture.
不当因为信主改变你家己国家的文化
don't change your culture just because you're a Christian now.
Unless,你的文化有问题。
There's a problem with your culture.
今天你讲不明白。
Probably you don't understand.
Let me explain to you.
Let me explain this to you.
亚洲人，咱基督徒真糊涂。
Sometimes we, as Christians, we are very not careful.
咱信主以后
，after become Christian,
咱感觉大行都改变。
We change everything.
大行都照圣经。
We have to follow everything according to the Bible.
Listen to me very carefully.
Listen to me carefully.
圣经是照全世界人。You're right, right.
You know that how good the Bible is, how right the Bible is. But there are a lot of things there that are culturally fit for the Jewish people and not for us. We believe in the truth, we don't believe in culture. Each country has their own culture.
But listen.
There's no culture that is perfect.
So when
you do things,
so because of the culture,
we don't do it because of our culture.
For example,
you go to the elevator,
and
when the elevator is open, how do you go in? Where do you stand? When it's open, you go in. There are people who stand in the middle.
Never.
Because you say that you're very dumb. Many times when you go into the elevator, we stand on the side. When you go in, there's this lady in there. It's only one lady there, and the whole place is empty. When you go in, where do you stand? You stand beside that lady.
No,
you don't.
It's not our culture.
Not to keep distance. We keep our distance. Even though she's very pretty. We just look.
This is our culture.
That's our culture. Many times, there are things that are culturally, there are culturally biased in the Bible.That's different from our culture. You cannot change your status. If you don't understand. In Hong Kong, If you're married, if you're getting married, it's different from a wedding here in the Philippines. In Hong Kong, when you're getting married, or in the Philippines rather, if you're going to get married, the husband will come to the church. When the groom comes to the church, what about the wife? The bride, she will come by herself. The bride will come by herself. But in Hong Kong, it's different. In Hong Kong, if there is a wedding, the groom will go to the bride's house and pick up the bride. So in Hong Kong, it's different. So the bride cannot show up. So once they are in the bride's house, and if the parents are still alive, you know what the couple should do? They would kneel down before the parents and offer a cup of tea to them. After the parents have drank the tea, they
will
give two red envelopes to the couple. And the groom will now bring the wife to the church. And the bride will, of course, cry before she leaves.
They're
Christians. They oppose this. You know why they oppose this?
Kneel down before parents.
Because they are opposed to the kneeling down before the parents. They say, as Christians, we don't need to kneel down before people.
We only bow down and worship God.
We only bow down and worship God. This is what we call those non-careful Christians. These are foolish Christians. They don't understand the culture.
Kneel down before our parents.
When we kneel down,
worship our parents.
When we kneel down before our parents, are we worshiping our parents?
This is worship.
In your heart, are you worshiping?
No, never. We show our respect to our parents.
Instead, we're just paying our respect. We're showing our respect. They have raised us up. Right now, I'm an adult. I'm about to get married. And I would like to thank my parents and offer this cup of tea to them. That's our culture. This is not about sin. So may the Lord help us. This is
a
very important principle that we need to understand. When we become a Christian, when we become a Christian, our secular identity, work, interpersonal relationships, racial, cultural, and all other relations may continue as before, as long as it has nothing to do with sinning. We cannot say that after we become Christians, we're no longer Chinese. Or we will not act like a Chinese. Now we become Christians. Your parents are Christians, you're a Christian. When you see your father,
hi brother!
You say, hi brother. Probably you'll be spanked. I'm your father. You are not your brother.
Yes, I know you. I'm your brother.
I know we are brothers in
but
Christ.
But I'm your father.
But I remain your father.
Please call me father, brother. Please
call me father. Sometimes we often force the biblical culture to our own culture.
So you get it.
We have to remember. If it's your personal thing,
你的工作,
your work,
你的生理,
your business,
那跟罪无关的,
it has nothing to do with sin,
peace as usual.
Then business as usual.
Unless
you know that if you continue on doing this, you're sinning, then you stop.
For example, 你没信主的时候,
before you're a Christian,
你是最毒的,
you're dealing with drugs.
So Duterte,
will look for you. So as you're a Christian, do you continue on dealing drugs? Of course not. Because this has something to do with sin. If we're not, it's not that bad.
For example,
your business, what kind of business? We go to the funeral homes. You're non-Christians there.
Right?
They're doing these paper offerings. Cars, paper houses, paper cars. That's my business.
Okay. 但我先做了,
After I become a Christian,
我继续吗?
Do I continue? Let me tell you.
Stop.
Because what you're doing has something to do with spiritual matters.
Trusting God.
You have to trust God. You have to find a new business.
I don't believe God will bless this kind of business.
I don't believe God will bless that kind of business. Because that kind of business, it has something to do with spiritual matters. So after you have to take this principle to heart. The culture doesn't change. But if it has something to do with sin, then you have to stop. Paul was afraid that they will not understand.
Example.
So he gave the second example. For those who are slaves. What do you do? Were you a slave when you were called, don't let it trouble you. Although if you can gain freedom, do so. For the one who was a slave when called to faith in the Lord is the Lord's freed person. Similarly, the one who was free when called is Christ's slave. Brothers and sisters, each person as responsible to God should remain in the situation they were in when God called them. This particular verse is the key verse in this passage. We should remain in the situation we were in when God called us. Circumcision is a matter of religion and culture. How about slavery? It's a positional problem. It's your social status. When a slave becomes a Christian, you remain somebody's slave. You don't have to come up and rebel. If the master grants you freedom,
praise God.
If freedom was not granted to you,
okay.
It's okay. Because you're already free in Christ.
Free
where? God has already set you free.
The truth will set you free.
Because the truth will set you free.
So
you're a free person.
So continue
to serve your master as a slave if freedom is not granted to you. Does it show that Paul was agreeing to slavery? It's not. Paul was saying you have to maintain and remain in the situation you're in. You're not about to rebel.
We live in peace.
Because the principle here is that we live in peace. We are here on earth
live
on a temporal basis. That's why we need to live in peace. But today we don't have slaves anymore. We have servants. There's a big difference between slaves and servants. There are servants here who feel that they're more important than their masters. If they're not happy, they will threaten to leave. I will not do this work, I'll leave. If they leave, they'll probably steal from you. Some of them might steal from you. So what do we do?
The same situation.
In the same situation, there's this brother. Before he was a Christian, Before the person became a Christian, he had a servant who was worshipping in the church. But later on, this employer became a Christian. So both employer and employee are worshipping in the same church. Isn't it very good?
Very good. Praise God, right?
But here lies the problem. When the employer and employee are worshiping in the same church, not soon afterwards, we heard the employee saying bad things about the employer. They say that he's very only focused on money. He doesn't really love the Lord. One time there was this activity in church and the employee wants to attend and the employer said, no, you cannot. So the employee started spreading bad things about the employer in the church. And I spoke with the employee, I said, you're wrong. I'm saying that it's not the problem of the employer, it's your problem. You have no right to say those things. If he does not allow you to undertime, then you cannot undertime. Why is he your employer? He's paying you the wage for that amount of time that you're supposed to work for him, then you during that the time belongs to him.
Right?
Is it right? I'm paying you wages. That 8 hours belongs to me, not to you.
I say no.
If you want to undertime, I say no. And you cannot say that the master or your employer loves the world. As employees,
submit to your master as submit to the Lord.
We must submit to our employers, our masters, as we submit to the Lord. If the employer said no, then we accept the no. It's not because we're Christians now, and he's your brother in Christ, and you can be very casual about it. True, he's your brother in Christ, but at the same time, he's still your employer.
You need
to know your position, you need to know your status. What was Paul saying here? These two examples, Paul wanted to prove one thing. In our marriage, not because after we've become a Christian, we need to change. Just like circumcision and slavery, we don't need to change our status. Principle here is unless your position, your situation, your status, and your culture is causing you to sin, then you don't change. If it's not causing you to sin, then continue on. Because as Christians, what is more important is our internal change, not our external transformation. If there are no internal transformation in our life, then whatever changes we have outwardly, it's but hypocrisy. Because if we change inwardly, then we can change outwardly. So everything starts from our heart.
So Solomon comes in the Jimian de Sijo is of Satan.
Proverbs 4:23. Do you treasure or protect your heart more than you protect everything else? You need to guard your heart because everything comes from our heart. May the Lord help us. This is the fourth question.
Question number five.
Is it better for those who are virgins or single to marry or not to marry?
Next message.
We'll talk about this.
Let's pray together.
Lord God, as we come before you, we thank you very much because you have spoken to us, Lord. You have made clear your plans for us, especially with regards to family, with regards to marriage and remarriage, Lord. We know that we only need to obey you and nobody else. We don't obey whatever it is the world is saying. We have to submit to you completely. Lord, bless our relationship. Bless our lives, Lord, so that we can show people who we are in you, that through you we can achieve great things for you. This is our prayer with thanksgiving in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen. Amen.